So I want to welcome everybody tonight to this panel discussion of the 10% Show. I'm Will Brandt. I'm the director at Gerber Hart Library and Archives. I'm here tonight with Lauren Harold, who is a PhD candidate at Northwestern University, whose research focus is on LGBTQ cable access shows. We're also here with folks from the 10% Show. We have Jack Ryan, who was the executive director, or actually producer, I think. Sarah Siegel, who is a co-host and a segment producer, and Tom Rowan, who was on the production crew, segment producer, and even co-hosted a few times also. Before we get started, I have a few informational things that I want to let out. We are recording this. It will end up on our YouTube channel, and on CanTV is actually going to be showing it too. Only the active speakers box will be recorded. So if you ask a question, you will be recorded. If you don't ask a question, you won't be recorded. Everybody but the panelists are muted. When we get to the question and answer period, if you want to ask a question, you can use the Zoom raise your hand function. So we know who wants to ask questions. To get to that function, if you're on a desktop or laptop, you can move your cursor anywhere in the video display box. The menu bar will appear at the bottom of the page. Click on the participants icon, and then a participant box will appear. And at the bottom of the box, there is a raise hand button at the bottom of that panel. If you're on a phone or a smaller tablet, you can tap the screen, a menu bar will appear. You press more, and then the raise hand option will display there. So once we get to the question and answer period, if you have a question, you can just raise your hand. Then Lauren and I will call on people, unmute them so you can ask your question, and then we'll go from there. So I think we're ready to begin. As I said, the 10% Show was a cable access show based in Chicago. LGBTQ monthly news magazine format. It ran 21 episodes between 1989 and 1991. The show covered a wide variety of LGBTQ life in Chicago, including politics, entertainment, and community organizations. I'm going to start off showing a short clip of one of the openings, very, very late 80s, early 90s. Many of the full episodes have already been posted at gerberhart.org, and eventually all 20 of them will be posted. So let me start off with showing this.
Welcome to this episode of the 10% Show. I'm Tony Wilkins.
I'm Sarah Siegel, and we're at the 1990 National Convergence of Girth and Mirth. On this episode of the 10% Show, we'll be speaking with Gabrielle Antolovich, International Ms. Leather 1990, who was here for a recent Women in Leather workshop.
And stay with us as we bring you our profile of PFLAG, Parents and Friends of Lesbians and Gays. Gordon Thomas has a new music video out, and the 10% Show's got it.
And we talked to the cast and crew of Vampire Lesbians of Sodom, all on the 10% Show.
Yay!
A little slice of what they did.
Yes.
Again, you can see all the full episodes at Gerber Hart, or many of them right now at gerberhart.org. And I will now turn it over to Lauren so she can start with interviewing folks.
Thanks everyone for being here. I love that title sequence.
And McDonald.
Looking forward to this conversation. And Jack, my first question is for you. Can you tell us how you got the idea to create the 10% Show?
Well, what had happened originally was in 1987, there was a march on Washington. And people from across the country, and I guess, you know, across the planet, went to Washington, D.C. to have a very large, like a protest about equality for gays, lesbian, you know, the LGBTQ plus community. And while I was there, I came in contact with an organization called the Gay Cable Network that was located in New York. And I got to know the people very well. And, you know, a little gay light bulb went off over my head. And I thought, I asked them, I said, you know, I stayed in touch with them. I said, I want to bring this show to Chicago. Because all at that time, I just wanted to have, you know, their show here. And I just thought I arranged for the a facility like Chicago Access to narrowcast, cablecast the programming. And what I found out was that Chicago Access says, okay, great, that would be really good, but here's the thing, you have to create the programming. Because I knew that's what I wanted to do eventually, but they said, oh no, you have to do that from the beginning. So we had to create a show under that stipulation. We could have excerpts from the Gay Cable Network in New York, but the majority of the programming had to be created by us here in Chicago. And that's how it all came together. The development of the 10% show was a very long, it took a long time to finally get the right people in the right slots. And it actually took a couple years. Actually, I used to tell Sarah, we had generations of people to try to put this together. And then eventually we finally got the right people and we were able to move together as one to start production, because I had to find an editor. I had to find camera people. I had to find on-air hosts. I had to find so many people and not pay anything. It was all volunteer. So I had to use abilities to keep things rolling and to have all these wonderful people do things for, you know, absolutely nothing. And it was a miracle, but we did it. And it was a really wonderful, wonderful thing.
Jack, we were rich in fun though, weren't we?
Yes, we were. God knows.
Tom? Yeah.
So Sarah, I'd love to hear from you and then from Tom how you got involved with the 10% show.
So I'm forever grateful to Pam McDonald, and I so wish I knew where she was today. Our girlfriends ended up with each other. So there's more of a story that doesn't need to be told right here. But I'm so grateful to Pam because she ended up contacting me. We were working together on the helpline of Horizons Community Services, which was a social services agency for the LGBTQ community back then. And we were co-volunteers on that. And she said, you're in video, aren't you, Sarah? There's this thing, the 10% show, we should go check out the first meeting. I said, not exactly, because what I was doing was selling radio, TV transcripts and audios and videos of news to PR firms and corporations. So like if the United flight landed in the cornfield of the Iowa hospital, I would have to next flight out all that news. That's not exactly being in video. But I said, okay, you know, if that's welcome, I'll go with you. So that's how it started. I'm grateful to Pam.
We found people in all kinds of different situations. Like we had a booth at Halsted Street Fair. So I was just talking to every, because people would come by and go, what's this? What's this about? What's this about? And we would discuss, and I found like three or four people just through those hundreds of people coming through the Halsted Street Fair.
I came along through the show by seeing a story in Windy City Times, at least I'm going to say it's Windy City Times, back in 1989, talking about the show, and they were looking for volunteers. And they had included a phone number, which I believe at that time was Jack's home phone number.
It was.
Was it then? Okay, so I called it. It was like on some evening. And at first I was talking to one of the other people associated with the show. His name was Mike Bawden. And I told him, you know, what I did. I was familiar with TV production. I was involved with a couple cable companies. So I had this background. I had gone to Columbia College, saw the show, and I thought, you know, I'm going to volunteer just to see what it's all about. And unfortunately, they had a shoot that weekend, which I could not attend, as much as Jack and Mike were begging me to do it. I'm like, I already have another commitment, guys. I simply cannot do it, but I'll be happy to show up at the next meeting. And back in those days, the meetings were held in Jack's apartment. And was that on Roscoe?
Yes.
Sheffield. Oh, okay. Yeah.
So here's 12 people jammed into poor Jack's apartment. And I'm the new kid on the block. And everyone was talking. I'm like, you know what? This seems pretty cool. This is something I can do. And that's how it just started with me. I was just trying to make myself as available as much as possible whenever there was a shoot or a segment that had to get done.
And Jack, can you tell us how you got the financial backing for the show?
Well, all of our funding was made possible by my first partner. He allowed me to spend tens of thousands of dollars and never said a word. And he was the most supportive person. And without him, it just wouldn't have been possible. And he bankrolled us and was supportive until he passed away in 1992. And it was about that time that I didn't feel like doing the show anymore after that. But it was his finances that allowed us to create this program.
Thanks for sharing that. Such a special story and contribution from your late partner. I'd love to hear from any of you who wants to talk about this, how you chose the topics and the guests for the episodes. And if you could also talk about, you know, why it was important for you to show a diverse portrayal of Chicago's LGBTQ community.
Do you want to start, Sarah?
Sure. I'm happy to. I think that it had a lot to do couple things. We had eclectic tastes, all of us, and curiosity, a lot of curiosity. I have to say, I didn't know anything about the LGBTQ community before coming, except that I had a girlfriend. Like, I came out senior year at the University of Michigan and tried to usher at a Holly Near concert, and nobody was friendly to me because I had long hair or something. And that was it. That's all I knew about the community. You know, I gave up in Ann Arbor and came to Chicago. And then through Jack, this whole world opened up, really. I just didn't know. I had gone to a modern Orthodox Jewish day school from grades 1 to 8, a public high school in Stanford where, you know, for the first time I had Black classmates. And suddenly in Chicago, thanks to also Bruce Koff with Horizons Community Services and volunteering with the youth group there, but then primarily with the 10% show, my curiosity led me, and so did Jack. He was like, well, we're going to do something on girth and mirth. Do you want a crew? You know, and girth and mirth, what is that? Okay, sure. You know, and yeah. And when, you know, to me, probably the coolest thing ever was learning about Thing magazine. And I know you didn't even ask this of us, but while I'm thinking about it, like, how did we end up going to the most diverse shoots? Thing magazine was a zine put out by a couple of really smart gay Black men. And I would have, without Ernest Haidt as my co-host and without that experience and learning also about Image Plus from Ernest, because he co-led it, I don't know when I'd have ever understood a gay Black culture, except maybe after I started reading Elin Harris novels. Okay, so I really got a lot out of just being asked to do stuff and also being curious. I have to say one more thing. David Levitt was coming to town, and he was a favorite author of mine. I was a comparative literature major, and he was a favorite. He was gay and he was Jewish, so that was right up my alley. Like that, I was totally comfortable with. To everybody else, that was really diverse. But But I said, we gotta, you know, go to Unabridged Books and you know, capture his reading. And it was so great. In fact, I have this picture. This is like a thrilling fan photo. I don't know if you guys can see it. Of David Levitt and me. He wrote The Lost Language of Cranes and Family Dancing and a bunch of really, really popular, fairly literary books in the 90s. I'm done. Thanks for letting me reminisce like that.
I'll talk a little bit about our, we had monthly meetings, or was it every 2 weeks?
I forget. It was like every 2 weeks, I believe.
Yeah. And what we would do, we would have a big round table, and we would sit there, and then we would start brainstorming. So we would, people would say, hey, what about this or what about that? And then the group would talk about it. And if there was a consensus, then right on the spot, we would say, okay, will you do the camera? Will you do the recording? Will you do the interview? And, you know, just that's how it would begin, you know, these meetings where we would figure out what we wanted to do. And a very large emphasis, very, 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 very important to me, and I believe to all my colleagues, was to create a program that was as diverse as we possibly could have made it. And we didn't want just to have a lot of boring white yuppie, gay yuppies, men, you know, everything's about them, about the latest disco or hairstyle or whatever. But we wanted to keep it really interesting, and we would juxtapose many different topics right next to each other during the production, because we would have something like incredibly heavy. You know, we would be talking to somebody that was getting ready to pass away from HIV. And then the next segment was drag queen wrestling. So it was something that was very important to us to keep a nice variety going and a really good positive energy, because we covered the political, the social, the cultural goings on of gay and lesbian Chicago. And it was a hell of a lot of fun. Tom, you're next.
What was the question?
How did we come up with the topics?
Oh yeah, like Sarah and Jack said, it was pretty topical. Some of the things, like Jack just mentioned, was drag queen wrestling. We ended up doing that at Bistro 2, like at midnight. Midnight, we were doing that at midnight. And then also like for Lesbian Vampires of Sodom, there was a play running at Royal George Theater, and they had a very limited run. So we knew what was going on, but we also wanted to get that particular segment on while the show was still in, people could see it. So it was very hastily put together, but everything came together very well at the end. And we were able to get our segment on while that show was still running. There were a few other shows with segments, not so much time sensitive, but we would do them and put them in the can, realizing we're not going to get them on in August, let's say, but we can at least do it in September. So some things kind of got moved around, especially like for the parade, we wanted to get that show up and running as quickly as possible, because everyone still had those memories fresh in their mind. It's like, okay, let's get this out here while people can still see it, they can still see their friends and what have you. So yeah, some things were very time sensitive, and other things it's like, we can maybe do this next month.
We had a lot of political figures too.
Yeah.
The mayor, we covered the mayor on our program. We had
mention which mayor. When you say mayor, we better say which mayor it was. It was Daley.
Daley.
And we had an exclusive. We had a real scoop, because there was a big contentious event at Ann Sather's in that restaurant upstairs. And it turned into a big screaming match. And ours was one of the, there was, I think ABC was there, Channel 7, but ours was the only other camera that was there. And we had all this great footage that even ABC and Channel 7 didn't even get. So my phone blew up the next morning, because word got out that I had that footage. So every single broadcasting outlet here in Chicago sent cars to pick me up so that I could bring the footage with me. And then they could copy it and make it part of their news programs that evening. And we had also Alder people. We had lots of VIPs. You know, we did frivolous stuff because we like frivolous stuff, but we also had super heavy duty, important things too.
You know what, Jack, I was thinking about getting together and how we're all, the three of us at least, reunited again. Here we go again with another pandemic. But I mean, it's just great that we're back together, whatever it took.
Yeah, so. we survived.
But you know what, Lauren and Will, I want to thank you very much, not only for letting us talk with you tonight, but I really enjoyed that pre-session you all did where you nerded out. Talking about what the 10% show and cable access mean to both of you, you Lauren as a scholar and you Will as somebody who I thought of this myself, but you said it, you know, it was one thing to have newspapers available, and that was actually the way I found out everything going on in Chicago was through Outlines and Windy City Times, and I completely, just like Jack's a hero to me, Tracy Baim is a hero as well, and but when you said that video, though, let you watch it as it was, shortly after it was happening, that was really cool. I myself hadn't thought of it. I was just going along for the adventures, as I said before. So.
Well, actually,
I was thinking that you guys sort of skewed my view of the Chicago LGBTQ community, because I thought it was a lot more diverse than it was, because that's how you presented it. So I thought there was all this spectrum, and
There was.
Yeah, you're presenting it. You just had to find it. So it's not as easy. You made it easy to look like it was easy to find.
Jack, what were you going to say?
Well, an important point to bring up is that right from the beginning, as you guys recall, we never did anything in the studio. We had a big studio at Chicago Access, which was lovely. But we never shot anything in the studio because anything in the studio dies. So we always took the cameras right where the action was. And that lent an important aspect of vibrancy and immediacy and excitement. And I think that really translated to our audience. And we had a very dedicated audience that, you know, they really enjoyed that kind of immediacy.
Since we're on the topic of audiences, can you all talk a little bit about how, you know, Chicago's LGBTQ community responded to the show?
Sarah, do you want to say something?
You first.
I would just say that we had a lot of coverage in the local publications, and Tracy Baim was an earlier supporter right from the beginning. I call her the Claire Booth Luce of Chicago. And she is such a phenomenal person. And right from the beginning, she did everything she could to expedite any problems we might have, or, you know, make sure that there was our programming was written about. And she also, we traded because we couldn't run advertising because we were on Chicago Access. They said, okay, you can't have commercial spots, but they said you can in the beginning and at the end of the program say this program has been brought to you on by, and then you can name, and we always, Outlines was always one that was part of it. And a very generous person was also the person that ran, I don't know if he owned it, but he ran Roscoe's.
And Jim Ludwig.
That's it.
Yeah, I don't know if Jim, well, Roscoe's is still in existence, and I think Jim is still around in some format. I don't know if he owns it anymore or not.
He was a great person, and he was a big supporter.
Yeah.
Every month he wrote us a check. It was great.
He and his partner, I think his partner's name was Mike or Tom. They were both very big supporters of us.
Yeah, yeah. So those are examples of people in the community. And then Art Johnson and Pepe, isn't that his lover's name?
Yeah, Pepe from
They were very supportive too. And actually they gave us some very needed equipment that we were able to use in making copies and doing different things, you know, nice old U-matic that we were able to foot to use. And there was a very, very positive reaction and support.
I don't have something extra cool to add to that one.
Well, you know what's great though too, I was just thinking, the support we got too, it was widespread. The leather community liked us a lot because we covered leather events. The women's community really liked our show because we did a lot of things in Mountain Moving Company. Or what was it called?
Mountain Moving Coffee House.
Coffee
you House. Know, finish that thought and then I want to say something. You remind me of something.
Because, you know, we went the extra mile to get the cameras to groups that didn't have a lot of exposure. Like at Mountain Moving, you couldn't be a biological male individual. You weren't allowed inside. But we found a way, you know, our women producers and camera operators and interviewers, we sent them right in and they had some fantastic segments from there. And we, you know, we'd always, do the difficult things. We wouldn't just sit in a studio. Would you come and sit, you know, sit next to a plant and talk to us? We didn't do that.
You know, I was going to say, in looking back, and thanks, Will, very much for transferring it up to YouTube for us.
Oh, my God.
It's amazing. In looking back at a couple of those Mountain Moving Coffee House interviews, I thought, how lucky were the non-female or non-female expressing people who watched the 10% show? It's true, you really would not have had a window into what was going on at Mountain Moving Coffee House if not for the 10% show, if you weren't a woman. So I think that was extra cool. And also, that International Mr. Leather, I promise you, I would not have walked through, what was the name of that hotel? I would not have gotten to go there. You know, I would not have thought about it on my own. And I had a window in, a very firsthand window in, just by being part of the 10% show. What were you going to say, Jack?
Go ahead, Tom.
Oh, I think the hotel that was for the International
Executive
Mr.
House.
Leather.
Yeah.
That was the old executive house, which is now the Wyndham Hotel.
Yeah.
And also, Girth and Mirth was at the Holiday Inn at McClure Court, which is now some Hilton thing or something. But yeah, I never would have gone to Girth and Mirth because I had no reason for me to go. But it was.
And did you have a ball there?
We had fun everywhere.
I really don't remember doing that shoot. I remember going there, but see, when I was always behind camera, I was more focused on making sure that we have proper lighting, we had the audio. While you guys could see what was going on and interact with people, I'm the one who was making sure, our battery just died. Let me go get another battery. Or where's the nearest outlet so I can plug this thing in so we can run off, you know, AC instead of worrying about battery power. So you guys got to have that fun, whereas I'm back with the camera on my shoulder, the backpack, lugging all the stuff all over.
I gotcha. Just as a FYI, Mirth and Girth is an international group. It's for larger men and their admirers.
That's right.
And it's around the world.
That group's still in existence?
Sure.
I wouldn't be surprised. I don't know. I wouldn't be surprised.
You know, though, speaking of having fun versus being behind the camera, I was with Sharon Marzano and others. I'm sorry, I can't remember who else, but Barb Netter, and we were at a zine convention. Probably Thing was there as well. But
I remember it. I was there.
Okay, Chuck.
What convention was it?
A zine convention, like magazine-only zines.
Before
the web was around, people handmade these. These zines. So. Yeah, I just have to, another moment of reminiscing here, but I'm sorry, Lauren, I should let you ask questions instead of, I can't resist.
You had a ball.
So much fun.
Just say we had a ball.
Well, I'm gonna be explicit about it.
No, it's wonderful to hear you all reminisce together.
So Go ahead, Lauren. I'll tell it in a while, maybe. Okay.
Well, I was just going to ask Tom if he could share. I know you had a story that you wanted to share about getting a fan letter from someone in Chicago's public television community.
Well, actually, that was something that Jack brought up. One of the questions you had brought to us was, what effect do we have on the straight community? And when I was talking with Jack the other day, I said, you got a fan letter from somebody at Channel 11 one day. And he couldn't remember it. And I was racking my brain. And it finally dawned on me today, shortly before the show started, it was a fan letter from John Galloway. Now, for those of you who don't know who John was, he was on Channel 11. He had his own show. He was pretty well known in the Chicagoland area for having very thought-provoking shows. And he, during the whole thing, time that we were on air, he took the time to not only watch the show, but he wrote a fan letter to us saying how much he admired the show, how much he thought of it, and he actually looked forward to it. So here is somebody who, John Galloway, was a pretty big name back in the days. He actually took the time to respond to us. And when Jack read that letter to us at one of our biweekly meetings, everybody was like, holy cow, we have really made somebody sit down and watch us and respond. And the fact that he was a respected member of the newscasters in Chicago, that meant a lot to us, especially to somebody who had a broadcast background like Sarah did, Jack did, and myself and a few others. It's like, this is really cool. So it really meant a lot to us that somebody in the straight community was watching the show.
Very much so. You couldn't get any more DIY than our group. We could have invented.
Jack, would you be willing to say what SBC Productions stood for?
Some people ask, because we would, our documentation would say SBC Productions. And people say, well, what is SBC Productions? And SBC Productions stood for shitty but cool, which was our philosophy.
I just love that.
Funky but good.
Yeah. I remember the other, when we were talking a few days ago, you also talked about getting some antagonistic responses to the show. Do you want to share a little bit about that?
Sure. Even during some of the shoots, people could be antagonistic. I remember we were covering some AIDS demonstration, and this man was saying these awful things. And of course, here I am having to tell Ernest, one of our co-hosts. And I said, Ernest, would you just go over there and interview him? And I'm like, oh God. And he did. And this man just, and we kept it in the show. He said, oh yeah, all these demonstrations about AIDS, I wish they'd all get it. The more the better. I'm like, okay, so that's part of it.
Jack, what you were saying earlier about us going out into the field, uh-huh, with that lesbian kissing in front of Water Tower Place, you're reminding me that there were two guys standing watching it agog, and
well, tell them what it was. It was the lesbian kissing.
Right, the lesbian kissing at Water Tower Place was a mass of lesbians of color. Not, mainstream, the usual suspects, but also women of color. It was really, I loved that it was everybody. And so a couple of guys of color were standing there watching it, and we were interviewing everybody. So off I go up to them and say, hey, what do you think? And he's like, it's disgusting. It's so disgusting. God did not make Adam and God made Adam and Eve, not Adam and Steve. And I said, well, this is Eve and Eva. And he's like, it's just gross, or whatever. And then a woman within earshot of the mic, maybe Sharon or Barb, maybe one of the crew people, or maybe one of the women in the kissin', said, then why are you standing here watching it? And the guy goes, come on, let's go, and they walked away. But I mean, we did get our share, and but what was so powerful was having a mic.
Right.
It's kind of like being the stand-up comic. You get the last word, with the bigots, and it was great.
We were pretty courageous because we did a lot of interviewing on the street, too. And that shit ain't easy.
That was literally on the street, right?
Right. You know, we would be on the street, and people would be walking by, and would you like to talk about X, Y, and Z? And you would have a conversation.
That's right.
And it's not easy to keep that ball in the air. But back to your point, though, about pushback that we did get, and that's because, you know, just us being ourselves and making our presence known, making our, gay and lesbian visibility, increasing it, you'll get pushback. And there were a couple times that I got death threats on my answering machine. But as I said a few days ago, I think everybody gets death threats for everything anymore. That's kind of like part of the modern age.
So you weren't too worried about it?
Oh yeah, I was. Because I had to make sure, because I was using my home phone. So I made sure that there was no address that they could get. And then I call up the phone company to make sure that, yeah, my address is still disconnected from that number, isn't it? They go, no.
Like, oh my God.
Okay, good to know.
No. But you're here, Jack, you're still here.
That's right. Yeah. Damn
Jack
it.
Is still here.
Yeah. Oh, it definitely was courageous to create this show.
All of us, we were all courageous because we were all doing things. A lot of people were, well, Sarah, you just mentioned you were out of your comfort zone. Sharon used to say that too to me. I would hear her talking to somebody else and she'd say, Jack, he makes me come out of my comfort zone and he makes us experience things.
I don't know what you guys are worried about. I was 6'5", so they could pick me out from 3 blocks away.
Here's
a man with a camera. He's 6'5". I think he's a target there.
Get him.
Well, before we, because when I was watching a lot of the protest videos that you guys did, you're often right in the midst of it. So when the police were pulling out people, they were pulling out people around you guys.
Oh yeah,
that was also interesting to see that you're that much into it.
That's why we wanted to take the cameras right where the action was. You're not going to get that footage under a green palm tree in the studio.
Before I ask the other folks on the call to offer their own questions, I want to ask you all one more question. How do you think the show impacted your life?
Go on, Tom, you go.
I think from the amount of people that we A, worked with, and B, the people that we met, I never would have met Sarah if it hadn't been for the show. I never would have met Jack if it hadn't been for the show. Some of the people that were crew for the show, I often think about them. It's like, whatever happened to so-and-so, whatever happened to this person, because for two and a half years, they were part of our lives. They were really part of our lives. And not only did we get to depend on those people, but we were genuinely interested in them as a person. If somebody was having a problem, we wanted to know. It's like, folks, there's your family and then there's your family. Consider us part of your family. So if something's going on, please share it with us. And we became very involved with that.
We had a nice group. It wasn't we had like about 15 or 16 volunteers. And, we were just able to find the three of us right now. But there were very, very vital people, such as Michael Bawden. Mm-hmm. He was our editor. Mm-hmm. And that man worked his ass off. I mean, because everybody had a full-time job. And then you had to come in, okay, let's meet at the Chicago Access Corporation. We got to mix the show. And that took hours and hours. And people were really dedicated and they really spent a lot of time. Sean O'Day did a lot of stuff for us. I just want to send a shout out to everybody that's still alive that did so much for us. And we really appreciated it. Sarah, how did it affect you?
So immensely. This is not show off stuff. This is just really what happened. Well, Tom, you were just talking about how this was a second family for us. And this is kind of a cliche that's, you know, we all grow up being trained by our parents, you know, to care about our whatever culture we grew up in, but nobody ever parents, you know, heterosexual, if your parents are heterosexual, you're not going to be taught about LGBTQ culture. You're just not. And I wasn't, but I was taught a ton about Jewish culture. So how cool that Jack opened up this world of LGBTQ culture for me. And I really never went back. And I, just as the show started, I did finally end up getting a technology company job. And I've been there ever since. And it'll be 30 years this summer, you know, wow. And I'll have been in a corporate environment. But here's the thing. I went into that corporate environment saying, you know, there's got to be a way for there to be LGBTQ advancement here in this arena too. And we probably could be an agent of it. I'm not kidding. I know that the 10% show was like following me the whole way. And we ended up doing the first business to business team of its kind in corporate America for the LGBTQ B2B market. And we started that up and it's still going today. It's more global than ever. I moved on from it, but it's a huge team at IBM, which is where I work. And I know that I wouldn't have had the guts to just say, hey, you know, I think there's a market we should, you know, be serving here. And to my employer's credit, it took a little bit of time, but it happened and it's thriving. So,
and it wouldn't have happened without you.
Thank you, Jack. But I really wouldn't have gotten inspired. Mm-hmm. And it was just so much fun. I was thinking of the most, here's like the thing that I should just keep as a thought bubble. But I was thinking, Jack and the 10% show made the AIDS era fun. Like how crazy, I know, how sick a thing to say. What I'm saying is, It was so heavy. It was such a heavy, desperate time. Mm-hmm. Jack's own husband, you know, partner, husband, perished. People around us were sick. People around us might still be sick. You know, it just was a heavy, heavy time, but we had some fun.
Mm-hmm. Definitely.
I think there's a lot to be said for joining together to create art and activism together in the face of so much death and disease and destruction. So that's a beautiful sentiment, actually. And so I want to invite folks to start raising their hands on the Zoom via the Zoom function. And while folks are doing that, I just want to draw your attention to that behind Sarah and Jack, they have these T-shirts. Oh. If you all want to show.
This was the original design. And the writing, that's my writing in red, where it says, don't stop.
Do you know what, Jack? I meant to quote that. The point is, I didn't stop.
We didn't.
That whole story I just told you about, how did it impact my life? Uh-huh. You said don't stop, and I didn't stop. So thank you for that. Yeah.
So. It was just really quick, I wanted to say how this affected me because I wanted to work Will into this. Because as soon as we ended production about a year later, I was thinking, well, it's not what good, I want to have all of these episodes and all of these hours and hours and hours and tens of thousands of dollars in investment to be available to gays to everyone. So I wanted to be someplace wonderful that would make it available. And that was Gerber Hart, the library there. And it was a great thing that it was there, but without Will, these episodes would still not be available because I faced decades of fighting an individual who did everything she could to lock them down and not make them available to people. You met her, Sarah.
I'm conveniently forgetting.
Well, Tom did too. People would go, they'd call me up. We went to Gerber Hart, but
oh, that's right. I came back to Chicago, went to Gerber Hart, and I was not allowed to view them. And I was incredulous, but whatever. Yeah. It's okay. All's well that ends well.
Say, oh, they're in the archives. You can't see them. Right. I'm like, what? Why is
so that? Again,
All right. It was like mind-blowing for decades. And then Wonderful Will came on the scene and made it all happen. Because I always played with the idea even after I donated them. I was thinking, you know what? I'm going to be probably long dead, and then they're going to be discovered by a very distant
archaeologist
generation, right? And as the years went by, I was thinking, oh, they're disintegrating. I know it, but we saved them, and I'm around to enjoy this, and to let other people enjoy the work that you all did.
Well, yeah, I mean, for a long time there, we weren't able to. We didn't know if our U-matic worked, so we had to get that going. But yeah, there was other issues there. But yeah, but it's good that you donated them at such an early time, because then we were able to preserve them properly. Mm-hmm. So now that when we're doing them now, people are able to view them. So I think somebody's asking a question, but I want to take a point of personal privilege and ask Lauren a question.
Oh. So
because Lauren, in part of your research, you've been watching a lot of different LGBTQ cable access shows of a wide variety. I was just wondering if you have a few thoughts about how does the 10% show compare to those, especially the news magazines? You don't want to compare them to the game shows, although 10% show had some game shows on it. But how do you think the 10% show compares to other news magazine LGBTQ things that you have looked at?
Yeah. I mean, the first thing I would say that is just the format. A lot of the other LGBTQ cable access shows that I've watched were also structured in a news magazine format to show sort of to have a variety of content, sort of match a variety of tastes in the audience. One thing I think is struck me as I was watching the 10% show was the sort of intentionality behind the on-screen diversity. I think a lot of the shows that I've watched were sort of created by, you know, white, cisgender, middle-class, gay men, and often those are the folks who are on screen in front of the camera, with, you know, some exceptions. But I could definitely tell watching the 10% show that the team behind it wanted to show over a wide spectrum of the, you know, Chicago's LGBTQ community. So I think that's right. You have a show about and centered in a Midwestern city, I think is really special. A lot of the shows that I've watched were created in New York, and most of the shows that I watch, most of the LGBTQ cable access shows are sort of based in New York. There were ones around the country, but it's exciting to watch sort of this history of Chicago's queer community unfold on screen, which unless you're going to the archives to look at, you know, the Windy City Times or the Gay Press back in the day, you wouldn't necessarily know who, what was going, you know, what ACT UP was doing in 1990. You wouldn't necessarily know that there were the Miss Leather competitions here. So I think that's really special to have this history of Chicago's queer community on screen.
So does anybody else have questions? I think somebody had a question, they unraised their hand, but maybe I asked it. But if anybody has any questions, okay, we'll let.
While we're waiting for questions, I just want to say
Jason has got his hand up.
Oh, cool.
Okay, I unmuted Richard. Rich. Harold?
Hi. Well, first, thanks to everybody involved in the creation and production of the show. It was a fantastic show.
Oh.
And a short conversation like this only provides the time to talk about, you know, a few of the qualities of the show. Although you know, I think a lot of the really important ones were covered. One I wanted to compliment you on is your coverage of the art scene and music, and my particular love, cabaret music, which was a real service. There's one episode where you had Barbara Cook, and I thought the two songs she sang were some of the best performances I've ever seen recorded of her. By the time I saw her live, she was way past that time when she was still in her prime. But I wanted to ask you about something else. I thought Sarah's comment a few minutes ago was very brilliant about how you made, the AIDS era fun. And you made me think about that. And I'm just wondering if you think that the existence of that existential tragic threat of AIDS also enabled your show or assisted your show to bring together a very diverse LGBTQ community that might otherwise have been more difficult. And sorry, there's a part B, speaking of more difficult. The other thing I think that helped the show was that cable, although by the late 80s, not in its infancy, it still had great penetration and there were still not too many channels. Now, there are hundreds of channels on the tube for those people who still have cable, and the number's declining. So if you were to try to attempt something like that kind of a show today, how would you do it, and what medium would you choose, and would you be able to reach such a broad audience? Sorry, that's about a million questions, but whatever you feel like talking about, I'd be grateful.
I can go, Jack, unless I should defer to you to go.
No,
first.
No, go.
So it's so interesting, Rich, that you asked that, because I've been thinking about it, and I do think that there probably is a connection to this idea of an existential threat. So one of the things that ended up happening after I moved on from the sales role was that I got into our learning organization, and my company sent me to get an education master's. It's kind of an amazing story, but the thing is, it got me into thinking about how do people learn online, and how do people learn virtually, and how do people learn through what we used to have something called Second Life. I mean, really virtual reality stuff. And then I was thinking now, and actually this inspiration came since Lauren outed you in the last episode, it came from your daughter, actually. and this conversation. No, but my inspiration, I was thinking, you know what? What is to stop us from having a show now that is Zoom-based? And remember I asked you the other day when we were talking, can you record a Zoom session and then put it up on YouTube? I've been thinking about it ever since, and I was thinking, in my case, I've met people, LGBTQ people from around the world, really, really from this, you know, being part of this global company. I don't think it would be as dynamic. You were talking, Jack, about us being in the field. So that's kind of problematic while there's a pandemic, you know, where we're not supposed to do anything but be masked. But I was thinking, what we'll lack in having the ability to get together, you know, in the field, we'll have more global reach. I can interview somebody in China, my friend Jimmy Chen, you know, and just hear his story. I can interview people. I mean, we can just really make this thing more global than it ever could be. So that's the upside of not being able to go live on the scene. That's anyway, those are my preliminary thoughts. How about you, Tom, and then to you, Jack?
Well, the world is so much different today than it was 30 years ago. You know, there's a saying in the community that each generation makes it easier for the next generation, mm-hmm. which is true. We didn't hear much about gay people back when I was growing up, only, you know, there was very few references to them. Nowadays, everybody's familiar with the term gay, lesbian, transgendered, bisexual, queer, what have you. Could we do the show on a Zoom? Probably so. Could you do it halfway around the world? Yeah, we could do that. It's all because of the way things have moved. 1989, cable, that was it. That was the only way to get the word out. There were magazines in Chicago, but you didn't have the same magazines that they would have in Rockford. So the show really opened up a lot of doors for people. Kids who thought they were different, there was a show for them to watch. They began to realize, hey, I'm not really that different from somebody else. So yes, things have progressed. And 30 years later, we could still do this. We could do the show. We could do it in the field. We could do it via Zoom, what have you. We could do it, no problem.
Yeah, I think there's a lot of social media that is at our fingertips. You know, there's so many different platforms and different places on the web where we could put our material. So we had to put all of our eggs in one basket, and that was Chicago Access. But now, I mean, there's so many different places, and it would be we would reach a lot more people. Mm-hmm. And but I still think we'd be really DIY as hell again.
And that's part of his charm. But actually, I do want to do a shout out to Chicago Cable Access. Can you guys see that? I know they're going to share this on their show. So, and this is.
That's a nice picture. Yeah, that's a nice picture. Okay. And what's sad, not to be a downer, but the two men on the end are no longer with us.
Sarah, put that picture up again.
There.
Oh, okay.
And that's Pam McDonald too.
There's okay. Pam. That's Ernest Hyde, who you mentioned a few times. He's in the middle. Who was the gentleman on the end there?
Alfredo Gonzalez. He was another co-host. Yep. Anyway.
Thanks, we have others that have questions, so I'll move to Jason and then Nicole. So, Jason, hi.
So I'm in the same program as Lauren is, but I study a broader lineage of Chicago television. And something I've discovered is that a lot of activist groups started to make videotapes and start to broadcast over the course of the 1970s. And I'm interested in how you understood those communities of video creators, video technicians, and what differentiates your work from theirs.
I don't have the pleasure of being familiar with a lot of the work that was done in the 70s. I think a lot of that was agitprop, I think, which doesn't mean it's bad. But I think that what was being done in the 70s was not as readily available. I think they were, For the most part,
they're on WTTW as opposed to cable access.
Okay, gotcha. Well, that's pretty widespread. Mm-hmm. You know, now that you mention it, yeah, there is a lot of things on that were on PBS. Across the country, but I wasn't that familiar with. Oh, that's right. You know, now that I'm thinking about it, you know, they were like documentaries, and they would cover a very important topic. You know, like migrant workers and different social situations. Yeah, they were very important. I didn't have much contact with them, is what I'm saying.
Okay. Because I've been talking to a guy named Tom Weinberg who produced a show called Image Union.
Right, that was important.
I think so too, but I'm curious why you weren't on it.
That I wasn't in touch with him,
or were you? I mean, No.
I knew of his reputation.
Okay.
Because he was an important figure on WTTW.
Absolutely.
Very important, and. He should be that topic of study too. Like, I guess you're studying his work.
I'm on it.
Okay, good.
Yeah, but Image Union used to be on like 11 o'clock or midnight on Sunday nights when a lot of people simply weren't watching it, and that was the only time they could put that show on.
Right.
Because, you know, WTTW was so driven by their fundraisers that if people realized some of the stuff they were showing, they would simply not get the money. So. Mm-hmm. It was groundbreaking to have that show on, but unfortunately it was at such a bad time. Nobody used to watch the show unless you were watching like after Monty Python.
It was like that. It was very creative. I remember that.
Yeah, there was stuff on it back in the days. Anyway, go ahead, Jason. I'm sorry.
Let me see, Nicole, do you still have a question?
Yeah, thank you so much for this opportunity to learn about the show. It's just incredible. I worked in public access, and the thing that's really standing out to me is how often you've all invoked curiosity as the driving force of the show. And I think curiosity is also often the driving force for audiences to watch public access, because there's such a wide variety, you never know exactly what you're going to get. And I guess I was just curious, I was interested to hear a little bit more about how curiosity shaped your approach to the show and your approach to building community.
Well, I was going to say that so much of the segments we would discuss, I had no idea, because I remember Mike Bawden coming up. He said, "Let's do a segment about theater oobleck." And I was like,
oh yeah,
I had never heard of that one. And that was our history. People would say, well, how about we do this? And we'd go, what's that? And we would actually be learning. It was a learning curve for all of us and all these different things. I mean, just learning about, remember the segment we did about lesbian strippers?
How can I not remember that?
No.
Yeah, oh, I do. It was a good one. It was really
wow.
Good.
So Will.
It was powerful because it was such a new concept.
Wow.
For back then.
I'm going to wait to see that segment.
Yeah.
Was that one of the last ones?
It could be.
Yeah, I've seen the raw footage tapes to it, but not
crashing.
Right. There was I ran across raw footage for it. Remember the leather lesbian nun?
Actually, no, but I do remember International Ms. Leather, and you do. I will answer the curiosity question because I remember Accio Bejas is still a luminary in Chicago. I hope she's still living in Chicago, but a great journalist. And she was at that International Ms. Leather seminar also for journalistic reasons. And what we didn't catch on camera, it's a very weird segment where it just cuts off after she says all this provocative stuff. And I'm like, well, thank you for talking to us. And it ends. What she said off camera was something that Achu thanked us for asking her more about. I'm just gonna mention this. She said, I asked her, and it was such a shame it wasn't during the interviewing process. I said, so can you tell us a little bit more about what got you interested in SM? And she said, yeah, you know, growing up, my mother, who was from Germany, had a lot of interesting artifacts, you know, and I think some of it came from that. And she said everything but the word regalia, you know. As in Nazi regalia. And so we kept talking friendlily. And I just said to her, can we go back to what you were saying about your mom? And later, Achi said, I'm really glad that you asked her that question. I hope it was Achi. It was Achi or Tracy Bain. One of the two of them said, I'm really glad you went back to that question. But it really, we were just a bunch of curious people. We just needed to know more. And I guess that's what, you know, I'm a, what is it called? Like not even amateur journalist. Okay. Just a curious person, but that's what journalists are, is curious. So
I think some of the best things we ever got was somebody would say something and that would lead the person doing the interview to pick up on it and bring out more information than what we were originally looking for. Cause it's like, hey, this is interesting to us. Hopefully it's going to be interesting to other people too. And you just kind of went with some of that stuff too.
That's true.
True.
Okay. Well, it looks like we're about 8 minutes, 6 minutes after the hour. So maybe it'd be a good place to wrap up. Are there any sort of final short comments you all might want to make?
I would just like to thank everybody that's here talking about this. And, you know, I'm getting up in years. I'm not going to be around forever. And thank God I lived long enough to see this.
And I just want to, Tom, I love you, you know that. And I really want to thank Jack for opening up my vistas. I really wouldn't be, I don't know how I would have ever gotten to be this
You really should be thanking
cultured.
Pam. You should be thanking Pam McDonald.
Pam McDonald, I did. I thanked her at the beginning of the show. I sure hope I ever get to find her. Yeah. So thanks. What about you, Tom?
Maybe she'll be seeing this and she'll get in contact with you. You know, this happened 30 years ago, and the fact that we're still talking about it really says a lot about Jack and his ambition and drive for all this. So we really do owe a big handful of claps and applause and thank yous to Jack Ryan and his partner, Tom, who saw us through all of this. So thank you, Jack. Yeah. And many birthdays, many happy more birthdays too.
That's right.
Thank you. And I want to say that all the people that did such wonderful work with us, because we didn't mention all their names, does not mean that we forgot you or that we are not as appreciative as we should. We might not remember all your names, but we know without you, this wouldn't have been possible.
Okay, well, go ahead, Lauren.
No, I was just going to thank you for organizing this. It's been so wonderful to have this conversation with you all tonight. I'm so glad we got to do this.
And thanks, Lauren, and thanks, Will, for bringing this all together.
Thank Terrific. You all the people attending, all the panelists, Jack, Tom, Sarah. It was great, and I look forward to us. We're getting very good responses to the YouTube videos. So
really?
People are really, really, we've had about a few hundred people actually watch those things.
Wow.
Those things. So yeah, you're getting a second life.
Thank you
again. So okay. We'll end the meeting here. Bye all.